Good morning and welcome. We are excited to see each and every one of you at Noelridge Christian Church today, and we ask that you are in a moment of worship and praise for our Lord Jesus Christ. I miss the fellowship time, and Phil and I were just talking about that passing of the peace and the fellowship, so sorry I was tardy in getting back up here. Lots of announcements in the bulletin I would like to draw your attention to. Some prayer concerns. Diane Evans lost her niece, Renee, who passed away at 49 from cancer. Roy Ford and the Welty family, Linda Ford passed away. It's Roger Welty's sister, and she had been under hospice care for several months. Joanne Sexton has been moved to the Hiawatha Care Center for physical therapy after suffering a broken hip. And she'd fallen twice. The second time she ended up breaking her hip, and I told her she needed to quit trying out for the Olympics because they were already over. So she kind of got a laugh out of that. Leland Omnison is beginning immunotherapy and radiation to attack his melanoma cancer. There's many other people on the prayer list, so we please ask that you keep them in your thoughts and prayers as they encounter struggles. We do have a praise. Annabella Mullenauer's 17-year-old great-granddaughter has completed treatment and is cancer-free. So congratulations to her. That's great news. Food court started up last Wednesday. Joanne's saying yay. We know the food is yummy. This week is chicken Alfredo or beef enchiladas. The next week is baked chicken and cheesy potatoes, and then spaghetti with garlic toast. So a wonderful time for fellowship. They are practicing social distancing. They are in need of several people to actually help with the cleanup. It's only about a half hour following food court. You get your meal free. So those of you who are penny pinchers, what a great way. Sunday school starts today. We've got Bible tots up to adults, so please see that information in your bulletin. Also, the NFL Ladies Night this Thursday at Edith and Lucille's, beginning at 5:30. So if you'd like to have a ladies' night out for dinner and fellowship, that would be this Thursday. Please let Linda Fisher know. There's also a fall rummage sale coming, so start saving your treasures October 14th, 15th, and 16th. More details on that to come. As we are in our time of transition, there are elders that will be at your call if you are in need of a pastor or someone to pray with or just someone to talk with. This month, during the month of September, it's myself and Lisa Stolba. So we invite you to reach out to us if you are in need. Following service today, there will be an update on the church, so a kind of a quick Q&A. If you're interested or have questions, please let us know. And I'm personally very excited. Next week, after a year and a half, is Arts for Africa. So you'll see that insert in your bulletin. It is a fundraising event for the Tumaini schools in Tanzania. This will be our ninth annual, so we're super excited to have this. We've got about 25 vendors, huge silent auction, and bake sale. And all the monies go to the Tumaini schools. And so I invite you to pray for good weather and a good turnout, and please come and shop and start your Christmas shopping if you'd like. Also, we have a guest with us today that Linda will come up and introduce, Sally Wiley with the Bowman Woods School Mission Moment, will talk with us today as well. I invite you to be in a moment of prayer. Dear God, thank you for your amazing power and work in our lives. Thank you for your goodness and for your blessings over us. Thank you for your great love and care. Thank you for your sacrifice so that we might have freedom and a life of faith. Forgive us when we don't thank you enough for who you are, for all that you do, for all that you've given. Help us to set our eyes and our hearts on you. During these unsettling times, we need your guidance even more for dealing with the ongoing reality of the pandemic and the safety of our children and families. Open our hearts to hear Phil's message today. Renew our spirits. Fill us with your peace and joy. We love you and we need you this day and every day. We give you praise and thanks, for you alone are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen.
As the praise team makes their way up here, I want to make one last announcement. Next week, after the service, I'm taking all the kids and the youth to the escape room. So we're going to have a wonderful lunch here at the church, and then we're going to take them to the escape room. And they're so excited about this because we've canceled it twice in the last year and a half. So we're encouraging them all to bring $5, but that's an encouragement. We want them to bring their friends, and we should be done with that event around 1 or 1:15. So don't forget that.
Sally? Hold on just a second, please.
Good morning. My name is Sally Wiley, and I am the school counselor at Bellman Woods Elementary, just right down the road on Boyson. I'm really glad to be here this morning, and I want to start out by saying thank you to all of you. Without your generosity, our students would not have all of the daily snacks at school. You have also contributed to many families' Christmas and Thanksgiving experiences. A lot of times when people in this area think of Bowman Woods, they think of all of our students being okay and having everything that they need. That has changed a lot over the past years. Our boundaries have changed, and we have a lot of students with a lot of needs, many students that only eat when they are at school. So thanks to all of your contributions with the snacks that I saw out in the lobby when I got here today, those students are able to take some of that stuff with them on the weekends. Christmas as well, you have sponsored many, many families. At this point in time, over 50 families that you have had tags on your angel tree, I believe is what it's called here. So it's just been so, so great, and it's great for me to be able to come and see all of the wonderful people that have donated to our students. You should see their faces when they get a bag of snacks for the week. It's 5 granola bars or some pudding and some crackers, and they think it is the best thing ever. So thank you to all of you for everything that you have done. We are so honored that your congregation has chosen us.
I sent you this video, so I'm hoping that you listened to it, because we sang it a few weeks ago, okay?
Lord, you are always here with me. There is no changing God in me. You are the same yesterday and today and forevermore. Here on your promises I stand. You hold my future in your hand. My solid rock, Almighty God, I worship you.
Let's try that again. Try that again, okay?
Lord, you are always here with me. There is no changing God in me. You are the same yesterday and today and forever. Hold my feet. my solid rock, almighty God.
Okay, first off, we've got somebody who started volunteering to help with Children's Moment. So we have Katie Francesca. If it's any consolation, I can't remember my own name. She's going to start helping out now and then with children's moments. So if you guys want to have a seat here. Okay, there we go. If you want to have a seat too. Okay. It's good to see you guys here today. Now, we're going to be talking today about how can God love a sinner like me? And we were thinking that, well, you came up with a really good point, Katie. Do you want to share that point?
Who at home makes mistakes? Do we make mistakes? Even grown-ups make mistakes. Okay, well, when we make mistakes, our parents still love us, no matter what, don't we? Don't parents love you? Yes, they do. Yes. Who else loves you when you make mistakes? Who? God, very good. God loves us when we make mistakes. So,
well, one of the things that we wanted to point out is with parents, when you have kids, you think they probably are going to make choices that are not good or not a good life lesson. Because we had this one case with my daughter. She tried during an ice storm scraping the ice off the windshield of her car with a metal shovel. Now, if she had asked us, we would have told her, that's not a good idea. So do you know what happens when you do that? Yes, and this was in the middle of an ice storm. So we had a car with no back window in the middle of an ice storm with glass all over the back window place. So that was an expensive life lesson. The thing with God is he already knew Jenny was going to do that with the shovel. And he still loves her. And we still love her even after paying the bill to get the window replaced. The thing is, from the beginning of time, God knew what we are going to do. And God still chose us to be his. And he still loves us even when we make mistakes and sin. So what we try to do is not make those choices, make better choices, and ask God for forgiveness when we do. So we praise God that he will forgive us. And that's the main thing, is that all we have to do is ask for it. So can we bow our heads and pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for your loving forgiveness for all that we do, when we try and fail, and when we don't try at all. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Pastor, may I speak with you?
You look pretty serious. Would you like to come into my office?
I think so.
Have a seat. So, what's on your mind, Isabel?
Well, I think I may have sinned. No, I know I have sinned. I'm a sinner.
Do you want to tell me about it?
I think so.
What makes you think that you've committed a sin?
Well, why do I not think my friends and I listen to you when you give your messages on Sundays? Because we're on our phones or messing around in the pews. I really do listen. Well, sometimes. I did hear you talk about sin a few weeks ago. Since then, I've been trying to see if I sin. And I have. An awful lot.
Well, tell me about your sins. You've recognized that you've chosen to do something against God's commandments?
I have. I have a list a mile long. I'm so bad. I'm never going to be forgiven. I'm never, ever going to heaven.
Well, let's talk about this. You're pretty upset, but let me assure you, God knows you and knows what's in your heart. He also knows all of us, being human, are going to make many, many mistakes. So let's talk about what you've done.
You know, you preached about the Ten Commandments, and when I thought about those, I realized I've broken lots of them.
Such as?
I've dishonored my mom by not making my bed every morning. And then when she tells my dad, he hollers at me. I just decide not to do it and make him and her mad. I swear at them using Jesus' name in vain because I want to be the big guy.
So, you recognize in your mind and spirit are not in the good place with your parents?
That's for sure. But there's a little more. My sister, she has lots of money tucked away in her hiding place, and I know where she keeps it. I don't think she knows yet, but I've been taking a few bucks now and then to buy coffees at Starbucks because everyone goes there, and I want to be like them. I'm a thief, too. I'm going to...
Isabel, calm down. Let's see what we can do to release some of this pain you're obviously feeling. So, from what you've shared, you recognize that you knowingly have done some wrong things, right? Do you remember what the Bible says we need to do when we sin?
Repent and say I'm sorry to God?
Yes, and what else?
Change my ways and do the right things.
Yes, because
God sent his son Jesus, who was sacrificed for our sins, and when we believe in him, our sins are forgiven, and we are accepted into the kingdom of heaven when we die.
Do you understand what that means?
I'm not good enough. I'm such a loser.
Isabel, none of us are good enough. We're all works in progress. That's why God loves you. God sees what you do, God hears you, and loves you because you love him. God forgives you and is encouraging you to try again. How can you begin to make things right in your life?
I can sneak the bunny back into my sister's hiding spot so she won't know I took it.
I'm wondering if there might be some honesty that needs to come forth.
Oh, I can't tell her. She'll just kill me.
Is your solution a right way of handling the situation?
Well, no.
I think you know what you need to do.
I know I need to start doing what my mom and dad tell me to do without arguing or ignoring them. They'd be shocked if I just did what they said the first time and not make a big production of slamming my door and yelling at them.
Yeah, I think you're getting an idea of what you need to do.
Oh boy, there's a buck coming on.
I might suggest that you confess your sins and forgiveness from your family in addition to changing your behavior. Your heart and brain will feel cleansed.
Pastor, that's asking a lot. I'm just a kid. Let me think about it, okay?
You're a pretty wise kid. You know that? I'm proud of you, and my door is always open to you. Let's say a prayer together. Dear God, we thank you for Isabel and the responsibility she's taking by acknowledging the sins she has committed. Through your grace and mercy, we ask for forgiveness while Isabel makes changes to her actions. Be with Isabel in these days ahead when she is tempted to return to these sinful ways, giving her strength to follow in Jesus' footsteps. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you, Isabel. You know what? I really wished I could take credit for that. I had nothing to do with it. Lisa Stobel wrote the script, and those two did a tremendous job of what needed to be said and what was said. Today, I really wished I was Baptist. Because the Baptists don't look at the clock. They can go on and on and on. I'll try not to. But today I'm glad I'm not Baptist. Because if I was Baptist, we would be talking about your sin. But today we're going to talk about my sin. How can God love a sinner like me? How is that possible? You know, the skit leads us to the Bible reading for the day. In the Old Testament, in Psalms, it says, as far as the east is from the west, as far as he removed our transgressions from us. And from the New Testament in Ephesians 1, 5 through 7 and 13 and 14, because of his love, God has already decided that through Jesus Christ, he would make us his sons and his daughters. This was his pleasure and his purpose. Let us praise God for his glorious grace, for the free gift he gave us in his dear Son. For by the blood of Christ, we are set free, and that is our sins are forgiven. And you also became God's people when you heard the true message, the good news that was brought from your salvation. You believed in Christ, and God put his stamp of ownership on you by giving you the Holy Spirit. He has promised his people and assures us that God will give complete freedom to those who are here, are his. Let us praise his glory forever and ever. You know, something bothered me a lot. When I would go to so many churches, they talk about a sinner like I, or they say that I'm not worthy. And I'm thinking, these are the people in the front of the church. They're special. They don't sin. How can they be praising about this stuff? How can they be talking about this stuff when they have such great lives and I have such a miserable life? I didn't understand. I still don't understand. But what kind of sins do they do that make them unworthy or make them feel like they're a sinner? In Galatians 5, 19 through 21, if you want to go into deep as to what's to sin, we could be like the Hebrews and be here for the rest of the day and talk about it. Carol, how many sins do the Hebrews have? 1,000 or some unreal number? They just go on and on and on. But read Galatians 5, 19 through 21 for the sins that they list, the things that they list that they thought is sins. A couple of things that really strike home to me is it talks about fits of rage, it talks about jealousy, envy, and a whole lot more. And if you've ever seen me in that little white car out there, That little white car does not like to go the speed limit. I don't care what the speed limit is. And anybody that gets into that little white car's way, we're going to have words. Because that little white car likes to run a lot. And I know it's a sin. And I know I shouldn't do it, but I do. And it'd be easy to see God forgiving these kind of sins. Who hasn't taken money from their parents or their brother or their sister? Who hasn't told their parents to go hang it on their nose when they told us to make our bed or to clean the house or to do our chores? Those are the easy sins. God can forgive those. We forgive those. Those are the easy ones. What about the hard ones? What about the rapist? What about the child molesters? What about the murderers? I have trouble forgiving them. I don't know if you do, but I do. I don't want them in my life. I don't want them to see God's grace. I'm mad at them. And don't even get me started about that football game yesterday. My wife looked at me and she said, "You really can't watch sports, can you?" And I'm going, "Nope, I can't. Absolutely can't." I was talking to Eva the other day, and Eva said something about what would Jesus do? Could Jesus watch a football game? Could Jesus drive that little white car out there? What would he do for that person that stands on the street corner that you see every day? Would he stop? Would he give him something? Would he try to find out what his story is? I was reading an article yesterday that somebody that's very near and dear to me sent me, and it was talking about one of the greatest fears today. Excuse me. One of the greatest sins today is fear. It was so great to see people in the stands and starting to come back to life. Does that mean that we need to be stupid about it? No. Do I like masks? No. Do I wear masks? Yes. Do I want a hug? You bet your sweet bippy I want a hug. Do I? Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. I feel comfortable with it. But I know that there's people here that don't feel comfortable with it. I want to respect your feelings. I want to respect where you are in this whole thing. Is it a sin that I don't? I see these kids on the buses, and like Sally said, these kids right now, we're seeing them go to schools, and I'm dropping them off for the breakfast programs and for the lunch programs. I'm seeing them wear their masks. I can see the fear in their eye. Today's church should be a haven for that fear. It's a sin to fear, and we need to open our hearts and our minds and look in the eyes of the people that are hurting and tell them about this great love that we have. One of the sins that I also commit an awful lot is I can have a real sharp sense of humor. And if you've ever been on the receiving end of it and insert you, I might as well apologize right now. Because I know I have it, and I try to be better tomorrow and today than I was yesterday. And if you don't think that I've had it my whole life, just ask my little sister. She's been in the brunt of it so many times that I know I've made her cry, and it makes me feel bad. But I want to do better. So what is it like? Today I actually had to wear socks. I wasn't allowed to leave the house without putting socks on. And most of you know that's not me. My toes right now were screaming that they want out. But I wore black because in my studies for this, I studied about a guy by the name of Johnny Cash. How many of you remember Johnny Cash? How many of you listen to his songs? How many of you hate his songs? There's a few people that do. But do we know his story? And it was said that he divided his time between sinning and seeking forgiveness. He frequently was going from jail to Jesus. He acknowledged God as the number one power in the world, but viewed Satan as a close second. I believe in that. You remember old Flip Wilson when he said, "The devil made me do it"? Boy, that was a motto for a lot of us. I heard it, and I probably lived it. He felt that God is in the business of saving flawed saints. The Bible is just full of them. I mean, you can read the Bible and you see all of the flawed saints that there was. But just like them, God will get us where he wants us to be. It may take a lifetime, but it will happen. You know, I feel a lot like Johnny. It is said that he was a natural backslider who kept God's number on speed dial. Yeah, I got that on my phone. It is all the time. He's always doing something that wants to bring me to my knees and ask him for forgiveness and ask him for strength and ask him for healing. So one of the things that it does is this all brings us back to the question, what sin is so bad that God can't forgive it? So we've heard a lot about the on the news about the murderers, the pedophiles, and the list goes on and on. In Matthew 12, 31 and 32, it says, "So I tell you that people can be forgiven any sin and any evil that they say, but whoever sins against whoever says evil things against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven." So blasphemy is the only sin that God doesn't forgive. So I feel pretty special that he hasn't left me the way I am. That he keeps trying to make me better. He keeps trying to make me the person that he knows I can be. And so one of the things that it brings me to is when, and I'm going to look at the board instead of you, so forgive me. But in the beginning, there was God, and God was in heaven. And he made the earth, and he made people, and I'm going to make a little stick person because I'm probably a worse artist than I am a speaker. But right out of the box, what happened? And who did it? Adam and Eve. Very good. Most people say Eve. A lot of people are now saying Adam. I say they both sinned. So right from the very beginning, sin created this chasm. And no, whatever we do, we always fall short of what God wants us to do. Always. I am like this. I probably run real hard and I come off like this. Because like I said, I sin a lot and I feel bad that I sin a lot and I try to get better. But even when I'm really good, maybe I only get to there. Some of you I know, I've been around you, I've worked side by side with you, I've listened to you, and I stand in awe of you, and so you probably get all the way about to there. But there's something in your life that keeps you short of God's full glory. Because there was only one person that never sinned. So what did God do? Because of his love, he sent us a special person, and on the cross, he went like this, and Christ built our bridge to God. So no matter how far we fall short, there's always a bridge to our wonderful God. His grace, his love, and there's nothing we can do because we will always fall short. It is truly the gift of grace that leads us to God. So in closing, I want to read this quote that I saw the other day. We may see ourselves as small, helpless, and unworthy. And others may view us that way as well. But God sees our potential. He knows what we can become, what you can accomplish for God if you truly believe you have his favor and his approval. Amen. Are you going to tell the story about this?
Sure.
Do it.
So this week, as Phil was putting together his sermon in the service, he asked me if I had heard this song. And he sent me a video. And I wrote him back and I said, well, I actually have that CD. And he's not a real well-known artist. So it was. I felt right away it was a God thing. And I said, I don't know where I've put that CD. I've had that CD for a very long time, and I used to play it all the time. And I said, I don't have the music to that, and I have a really busy week. I will try to find the music. And I went ahead and called the number that I thought would lead me to the publication of this song. And I talked to a lady that was actually one of the composer's best friends. And she said, I can't give you his number. But I will call you back. And she called me back and she said, Greg Ferguson is so excited that you want to sing this song. And he's just going to give the song to you so you can use it in the service. And then I told Phil, and Phil said, well, I think this is a wonderful story because Greg had a big hand in leading my wife to the Lord. And they had been to that conference. And I don't know if Phil was at the conference at Willow Creek when I was there, but we probably were there at the same conference and we didn't know each other. So this is a song that I remember playing so much and that meant a lot to me many years ago. And it's so beautifully written, and it talks about what you heard in this lovely sermon that Phil shared with us. It's called I Stand, I Fall. Stand, I fall, you take my hand, you give me grace to stand again, you teach, you test me, we try again, until I understand. miserably. You pick me up so patiently. You walk me back where we began, and we begin again. The lessons are in me. Your patience unbelievable. Stumbling into holiness is the only way. I learn, I guess. Stand, I fall, you take my hand, you give me grace to stand again, you teach, you test me, we try again, until I until I understand.
Special song, wasn't it? You can see I still, every time I hear that song, I cry my eyes out. So let's talk about communion. Last time I was here and preached, we talked about what it would have been like to have been in that room. Now I want you to take a look at this picture. Study this picture. Is there any sin in this room? Did Jesus know that he was going to come to this room and have so much sin surround him that he was led to do something to change the course of history? Who's sitting at the right hand of Jesus? That's the honored seat. Was everybody else in the room jealous because they had to sit on the left or on the end of the table? Were they envious of the guy that got to sit in that seat? What would it have been like to have my Savior wash my feet and me to be so oblivious that I didn't realize the importance of that? Did sin lead Jesus, that after the meal was broken, that he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat." In like manner, he took the cup. And he said, "This is the new covenant of my blood. Every time you drink of it, think of me." And for as often as we eat the bread and drink from the cup, let us remember the sweet gift of grace that he gave us.
Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, as disciples and sinners, we are invited to this holy communion table each and every week, and what an honor that is. Today, as we partake of the loaf and of the cup, we are mindful of your Son's sacrifice for each one of us and for all of our sins.
Let it nourish our bodies, our minds, and our souls to do the work that you desire in each one of our lives. You are an awesome God. Amen. As we continue to prepare, let us confess our faith. I believe in Jesus as the Christ, the Son of the living God, and I seek to follow him as my Lord and Savior. So as we come to our offering meditation, the scripture, Psalm 103, talks about David's desire to praise God for all that he has done. God has bestowed his personal blessings on each one of us. So let me ask you, what are you grateful for? What blessings have enriched your life? For me, I'm grateful for Noelridge Christian Church and the fellowship we share together. I'm grateful for my almost 3-decade career in radio sales and to share my income for those who are less fortunate. For my love of travel and immersing myself in different cultures, for the Tumaini schools in Tanzania and my passion to help these children. So we give to be blessed. If we participate in the harvest that God has for each of us, let us sow our gifts for him today. We give from the heart. We give because that's why God created of us, to enjoy him and to bring that joy to others. You all have very many gifts. Some are called to give more, and some are called to give less. But when we are called to give, we are called to give generously. So there's a collection plate on the table as you enter the sanctuary. You're invited to leave your tithes and offerings there, either before or after the service. We will now accept the morning tithes and offerings. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the generosity of those in the pews today. We ask your blessings on these tithes and offerings to do the work that you desire within our church, our community, and your world. In your name we pray. Amen.
So yesterday, television, besides football, was covered with wall-to-wall coverage of what event? 9/11, 20 years later. I don't like Michigan. I don't like Michigan football. I don't like their stinking stadium. I don't like anything about Michigan. But I saw at the beginning of the game that they pulled a flag out that literally covered the entire field, 100 yards long, 50 yards wide. And then they had a choir from Detroit sing God Bless America. I look back to those days, and I think of the unity that we had as a country. The unity that we had as a people. Will that ever come back? Are we the vehicle to make it happen? We God's people. We God's church. It seems in the last 20 years it's not been cool to be a Christian. It's not been cool to be a churchgoer. I just pray that the church becomes relevant again. And the only way it's going to become relevant is for us. So would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, lest we never forget that terrible day that so many people lost their lives due to hate. We ask you to spread your grace greater than it's ever been spread before. We ask you to give our leaders insight and strength and the courage to do the things that would honor you and honor the people. I ask you to be with the kids today, as so many kids are growing up in this world of masks and vaccines and vax people hating unvax people and vax people hating vaxed people. And just pray that we come together. Pray that you can spread a degree of understanding for all of us. Pray that life will come back to normal in these kids that are living in this world today, and the suicide rate among young adults is out of this world. Pray for them. Let them know that the church is here for them, to give them love, to give them grace, and to sometimes just giving them the stuff, the food, the housing, the stuff that makes life bearable. Make us strong. Make us prosper. Make us be what you would have us be. And we thank you so much that you sent Jesus into our life, that he was able to give us that example of how we should live. For we all know we live in a sinful world, and it's only when we put our trust in you and try harder are we better today than we were yesterday. Give us the strength. Give us the courage to be proud to say we are Christians and we go to church and we would love to have you come with us. Because that's what Jesus would do. Because he taught us a prayer that tells us how to lead our life. And it goes like this. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Persons desiring to make their confession of faith in Jesus Christ or place their church membership with this congregation may come forward during the hymn of invitation. I'm sorry. I will just add something to it. This church is the hope of the world. This church is the hope for Cedar Rapids. This church is the hope for individuals that we don't even know yet, but we want to. Help us to become relevant in today's society. Thank you.
Please stand. Grace greater than our sin.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled.
I almost did something. I don't know if you've seen me do this lately, but I do this, bless you, my children, for I have sinned. And I really feel that way today. But I want you to go with God's grace in peace and mercy and to serve the Lord. Amen.